Hello everyone, myself Dr. M. Srijan Kumar. My education background is pharmacy. Today's topic is Introduction to Pharmacokinetic Modeling. Let's move on to the topic. Coming to the definition of pharmacokinetics, it is the study of kinetics of drug absorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion, and their relationship with the pharmacologic, therapeutic, or toxicologic response. Now we will understand the definition in detail. Here it is given, kinetics of drug ADME. What do you mean by the term kinetics? It is a branch of chemistry or biochemistry concerned with studying and measuring rate of reactions. Now in what way this chemistry related rate of reactions are related to our current pharmacokinetic modeling? Let me explain. Any drug that has been administered, it will enter into the systemic circulation by crossing various barriers. After that, it will change its chemical form, thereby it will eliminate it from our body. So if you see all these processes, these particular processes can be expressed mathematically by the rate at which they proceed, the order of processes, and rate constants. Okay, if you see entry of your drug, passing through various barriers, entering into systemic circulation, changing into chemical form, and eliminated from our body, nothing but moving out from our body. All these processes are mathematically expressed by three things. One is rate, order of processes, and rate constant. Now we got an answer. In what way this rate of reactions or your kinetics are related to our current pharmacokinetic modeling? Not only that, so when you say absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion, what do you mean by the term absorption? Passage of drug molecules from the site of administration into the systemic circulation is called as absorption. Coming to the distribution, reversible transfer of a drug between the blood and the extravascular fluids and tissues of the body is called as distribution. Coming to the metabolism, drug metabolism is the chemical alteration of the drug by the body. This is the definition of metabolism. Coming to the excretion, irreversible transfer of drug or metabolites from internal to external environment is called as excretion. Okay, that's all about your ADME definition. Coming to the last line, and their relationship with the pharmacologic, therapeutic, or toxicologic response. So first you need to study the kinetics of drug absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion. And after studying all the kinetics of these four ADME processes, you need to relate with your pharmacologic, therapeutic, or toxicologic response. This is the definition about your pharmacokinetics. In order to clearly understand about what is absorption, what is distribution, what is metabolism, and what do you mean by the term excretion, you can just go subscribe to my channel and you can find a video concerned with all these four processes, introduction to ADME. Please watch that video. You will really understand what is the point of entry into our body and what is the point of elimination, and from entry to elimination, what are the processes involved and what exactly happens, you can learn from that video. Thank you. Next, moving on to factors determining the pharmacokinetics of drugs. Following after administration of a drug, the prime factor need to be considered is administration site or route of administration that plays an important role in pharmacokinetics. In what way? There are different routes of administration like oral route of administration, nasal route of administration, ophthalmic route of administration, parenteral route of administration, etc. The ADME processes will vary according to the route of administration. So the route of, if you consider the route of administration is an oral route of administration, the next factor need to be considered is your absorption. When the drug passes your absorption phase, it will enter into your systemic circulation. Now we need to find out what is the drug concentration in the circulation system. That can be assessed by two factors again. One is drug distribution, the other one is bioavailability. Bioavailability is nothing but availability of a drug in systemic circulation. That is called your bioavailability. When you say drug distribution, that means drug after entering into your systemic circulation, it may distribute to your target tissue, it may distribute to the other tissues. So volume of distribution can be calculated by using a formula: total amount of drug divided by plasma concentration will give you volume of distribution. After considering your bioavailability, drug distribution, then you'll be moving on to the next factor called as clearance. So clearance is nothing but rate of elimination divided by plasma concentration will give you the clearance. Rate of elimination divided by plasma concentration will give you the clearance. And this elimination can be done by two processes. One is metabolism, the other one is excretion. Elimination process can be done by two things. One is metabolism, the other one is excretion. So all these factors, if you can have a look, okay, here four important processes you can see. One is absorption, followed by distribution, followed by metabolism, followed by excretion. These are the factors that determines your pharmacokinetics of drugs. Coming to the applications of pharmacokinetic models, pharmacokinetic model helps us to study behavior of drug in patients. A patient got administered with a drug. Drug after entering inside the body, it undergoes absorption, distribution, metabolism and excretion. Based upon the assessment of these four processes, we can easily assess the behavior of a drug in patient. Second one, to predict concentration of drug in body fluids. Body will be having different compartments like extravascular compartment and intravascular compartment. What is the concentration in each compartment can be assessed by applying this pharmacokinetic models. Not only that, it helps you to assess the concentration in dosage regimen. What do you mean by dosage regimen? This is nothing but schedule of doses of medicine, including the time between the doses, the duration of treatment and the amount to be taken each time. It also includes how much medicine to be taken and what formulation or dosage form in which the medicine will be taken. So in order to predict the concentration in such dosage regimen, also a pharmacokinetic model will be helpful. And to calculate multiple dose concentration curves from single dose, when you can obtain a single dose data based upon the pharmacokinetic model, you can easily extrapolate to multiple dose concentration and you can calculate the multiple dose concentration curves. And it also helps you to calculate what is the optimum dosage regimen for an individual patient. Not only that, it also helps you to calculate possible drug or metabolite accumulation in the body. Any drug after entering inside the body, it has its different pathways. Okay. And what are the possible drug or metabolite that has been accumulated in each and every part of your body can be assessed with the help of pharmacokinetic models. It also helps to evaluate the risk of toxicity. What is the maximum concentration of the drug that leads to toxicity can be assessed by applying this pharmacokinetic model. And it also helps you to evaluate bioequivalence and bioinequivalence between different formulations of same drug, because we know that a same drug will be available in different formulations in the sense in different dosage form. So the bioequivalence and bioinequivalence between these different formulations of the same drug can be assessed with the help of a pharmacokinetic model. Okay. Next, evaluate the influence of altered physiology or disease state on drug ADME. So we know that ADME are the process that runs in our body. Okay. So any drug that will be taken, it undergoes ADME. So if it is a healthy individual, it is okay with that. But if that particular individual has an altered physiology, like enzymatic degradation or any organ damage or some kind of altered physiology or any disease state that has been prevailed in the patient's body, okay, in what way this altered physiology and disease state will impact your ADME can be studied with the help of pharmacokinetic models. Next, correlating plasma drug concentration or pharmacological response. What is the plasma drug concentration obtained? With that, what is the pharmacological response obtained that can be correlated with the help of pharmacokinetic model? Because based on the plasma drug concentration, the pharmacological response will be there. The pharmacological response is dependent upon your plasma drug concentration. The correlation between these two can be explained with the help of pharmacokinetic models. Next, explaining drug interactions. So drug interactions in the sense drug-drug interactions or drug-food interactions, whatever that interactions that will be prevailed inside the body can be explained with the help of pharmacokinetic models. Okay, that's all how your pharmacokinetic models are helpful in studying n number of parameters. Next, moving on to classification of pharmacokinetic models. There are many classifications of pharmacokinetic models. Present flowchart demonstrate two general approaches to pharmacokinetic modeling. One is compartment based modeling, the other one is non-compartment based modeling. Now let us move on to the classification. Pharmacokinetic models are divided into two types. One is compartment models, the other one is non-compartment models, based upon the quantitative structure pharmacokinetic relationships. These compartment model again divided into two types. One is physiological model, the other one is mechanistic model. These physiological models are again in turn divided into three types. One is whole body model, the second one is partial body model, the third one is metabolism model. These mechanistic models in turn divided into two types. One is mammillary model, the other one is catenary model. That's all about your classification. Now let us move on to an interesting topic, compartment models. Now, what is a compartment? Is it a train compartment? However, if it is a train compartment, how this train compartment is related to our body? To understand compartments, think about your heart for a minute. A human heart has four distinct chambers, each with a specific function. Blood, which has been depleted of oxygen, returns through the veins to the right atrium. From right atrium, blood is pumped to right ventricle. From there, it is pumped to the lungs. From there, it will be pumped to the left atrium. From there, it moves to the left ventricle. This is how blood flow from right atrium to the left ventricle. So, each chamber of the heart has a specific function and there is a specific flow of blood involved. The following schematic depicts the four chambers of the heart along with the direction of blood flow. If you can see the image, the blood that has been started from right atrium, it is moving to right ventricle. From there, it is moving to left atrium. From there, it is moving to left ventricle. What do you understand from this? So each chamber of your heart is considered as one compartment. Okay, right atrium, one compartment. Right ventricle, compartment number two. Left atrium, compartment number 3, and left ventricle is compartment number 4. So blood is flowing from one compartment to 2, from there to 2 to 3, and from 3 to 4. So what you can say from this, the flow of blood is unidirectional. From this particular image, you can say that the flow of blood is unidirectional flow. As you can see, the blood has unidirectional flow from one chamber to the next chamber as discussed. In other words, the blood does not move from the right ventricle back into the right atrium. At least it doesn't happen with a normal healthy heart. As I said you that the blood from right atrium will move to the right ventricle. From there it will move to the left atrium. From there it will move to the left ventricle. But it will not happen something like blood moving from right ventricle to the right atrium. Okay, because it will never happen in a normal healthy heart. If this makes sense to you, then you now understand the idea of compartments. In a very real way, the chambers of the heart are separate compartments that the blood passes through. Okay, whatever the four chambers that are present in the heart, that four chambers are considered as separate individual compartment into which the blood passes. In pharmacokinetics, we don't use tangible compartments like the chambers of the heart. Okay, these chambers of the heart, the arrangement of chambers of the heart, it is something like a tangible compartments. These tangible compartments will not be using in pharmacokinetic models. Instead of that, we will be using theoretical or imaginary compartments. So, instead of defining tangible compartments, we design theoretical compartments with unique names like 1, 2, 3, that is central, peripheral, etc. So, instead of using tangible compartments, we use what? We use theoretical compartments. When you say theoretical compartments, these theoretical compartments will be given some unique names like compartment 1, compartment 2, compartment 3, etc. Compartment 1 will always considered as central compartment. 2, 3 and etc. will be considered as peripheral compartments. I hope you understood. Then what we do? Then we draw arrows between these compartments to show how the drug travels from one compartment to the other. After naming the compartments like one compartment, two compartment and three compartment, in between the compartments, we are going to draw some arrows. These arrows will provide you the information about how the drug travels from one compartment to the other compartment. Okay. Based upon the previous slide, I hope everyone are having an imaginary idea about how a compartment model will look like. Let's move on to classification of compartment model. These are divided into two types. One is physiological model. The second one is mechanistic model. Moving on to the mechanistic model, the present slide. These mechanistic model are divided into two types. Mammillary model and catenary model. So, what do you mean by mammillary model? It consists of a central compartment interacting with a number of peripheral compartments surrounding it. So, can you see the second image? I have clearly mentioned it as a mammillary model. Okay, what it consists of? It consists of a central compartment. Okay, interacting with the peripheral compartment like 2, 3 and 4. Okay, surrounding central compartment. If you can remember what I explained about your compartment model, so each compartment will be given unique name like compartment 1, compartment 2, compartment 3, compartment 4, okay, like central and peripheral compartments, okay. And between two compartments, okay, there will be an arrow drawn indicating how a drug moves from one compartment to the other. These are the points I have discussed over there. The same thing. So, each compartment, if you can see, central, one number has been given. The three peripheral compartments, 2, 3 and 4. Clear? So, considering central compartment 1 and peripheral compartment 2, in between, you can see two arrows. One arrow is denoted as K12. The other arrow is denoted as K21. What are these? K is nothing but, K corresponds to rate constant. K corresponds to what? Rate constant. If you can remember the first slide, what do you mean by pharmacokinetics? It's a kinetics of drug absorption, distribution, metabolism and excretion. There I explained everything about kinetics. Why I have explained in depth about kinetics, all of a sudden if I say here, it is a rate constant. Are how come this rate constant is related to our topic? So that's the reason I explained there. So I explained that your kinetics will depend upon what? Rate process and constant. So, K corresponds to rate constant. So, arrow indicating drug movement from one compartment to the other compartment. So, central is the first compartment and your peripheral is the second compartment, right? So, if you can consider one and two compartments, drug movement from 1 to 2, it is denoted as K12. And again, drug return from 2 to 1, it is denoted as K21. In the similar way, drug movement from 1 to 3, K13 and K31. In a similar way, drug movement from central compartment to fourth compartment, K14 and K41. Okay, this is the explanation about your mammillary model. So, always remember one thing, the elimination will be from your central compartment. After drug entering into your systemic circulation, there it will get distributed to different organs. Okay, so when you say different organs, that particular organs are highly perfused organs. Okay, that organs are highly perfused organs. When you say it enters into systemic circulation is nothing but plasma. Okay, so central compartment examples are your plasma and highly perfused organs like your lungs, liver and kidney, etc. And peripheral compartments are the compartments of low vascular and poor perfusion. Peripheral compartments are the compartments of low vascular and poor perfusion like adipose tissues. Okay, so here you need to make an important point that drug will enter into central compartment, from there it will get distributed to the peripheral compartments, from peripheral compartments again the drug will get returned into your central compartment, from there the elimination will be done. Okay, this is about your mammillary model. Next, going on to catenary model. So this catenary model comprises of chain of interconnected compartments. The disadvantage of this catenary model is that this particular model is rarely used. Why? Because the reason is this particular system of interconnected compartments in a series, okay, which will be not observed physiologically or anatomically in our body. Why? As the various organs are directly linked to the blood compartment. Why? Because the organs are directly linked to the blood compartment. So, this particular series of interconnected compartments cannot be seen anatomically or physiologically in our body. So, that's the reason this catenary model is rarely used. I hope you understand. In catenary model also, if you can see K01, that is nothing but initial dose of a drug. Okay, that has been entered into your central compartment. From there, it is moving on to say, peripheral compartment number 2, from there number 3. Okay, from there successive next compartment. This is how drug movement from one compartment to the other compartment. This is about your mechanistic model. I hope you understood. Next, moving on to physiologic models. The physiologically based pharmacokinetic model was introduced by Haggard. Haggard was the person to introduce this physiologically based model. They are also called as PBPK models. The concept was to divide the body into physiologically relevant compartments or major organs and to formulate a mass balance differential equation for each compartment describing the fate of substance within that compartment. Okay, what is the main reason or concept behind this physiological model? You know, the main reason is that first, to divide the body into physiologically relevant compartments or organs. After that, you need to formulate a differential equation. Some equation has to be designed for each compartment to describe what is the fate of substance within that compartment. Okay, I have given a diagrammatic representation about your physiological model. It's an example. Okay, the PBPK models include the following three types. As I told you in the classification itself, physiological models are divided into three types: whole body model, partial model and metabolic. Okay, so coming to the whole body, using a closed circulation concept. Can you see here? It is a closed circulation concept. Okay, closed loop circulation concept is your whole body PBPK model. Next, coming to the partial PBPK model, isolated body systems like perfused hind limb or gastrointestinal tract, etc. Considering an isolated body system, okay, any one system, it is called as partial PBPK model. For example, if I want to study something about GI tract, that is an isolated PBPK model. If I want to study the whole body, that whole body is nothing but closed loop circulation concept. Next is the metabolic PBPK models. This metabolic PBPK models describes mainly about your hepatic elimination of your drugs using physiological and biochemical parameters. It is mainly concerned with your hepatic elimination of drugs. Okay, it might be a physiological parameter, it might be a biological parameter which helps for a drug to eliminate through hepatic route of elimination. So example, liver blood flow, intrinsic clearance, protein binding, etc. The examples for your metabolic PBPK model are liver blood flow, intrinsic clearance, protein binding, etc. And the main equation that can explain your metabolic PBPK model is Michaelis-Menten equation. The equation that can explain your metabolic PBPK model is Michaelis-Menten equation. If you can see this closed loop circulation concept, you can see the plasma, you can see the different organs like liver, GI tract, kidney, muscle, bone, fat. And QM, QK, QB are nothing but blood flow rate. Blood flow rate from one compartment to the other compartment. QB is nothing but blood flow rate that has been entered into bone and that has been coming out from bone. Okay. All QB, QM, QA corresponds to the individual organ blood flow rate. Okay. Q corresponds to the blood flow rate and that aromas corresponds to the blood flow rate from one compartment to the other compartment. This is everything about your physiological models. Next is non-compartment model. It is also called as model independent method. It does not require any sort of assumption of specific compartment modeling and it does not depend on anatomical structures or physiological properties. And this particular non-compartment model has been used to derive following three properties. The first one is estimation of pharmacokinetic parameters, example area under curve with mathematical integration of experimental data that can be given by the equation that has been given here. AUC is equal to, AUC is nothing but area under curve is equal to integration of 0 to infinity CT concentration at time t into dt. Okay, next one is description of the relationship between the input rate and the resulting systemic drug concentration using a convolution integration equation. So this particular equation gives a relationship between the input rate and the resulting systemic drug concentration using a convolution integration equation, that is concentration at time t that is equal to integration of 0 to t into c into t minus time minus time interval into R, that is nothing but response function from an instantaneous input of a unit amount of drug. Okay, and your tau corresponds to your drug input and duration into dt. This is the equation to give a relationship between your input rate and the resulting systemic drug concentration. And the third property is to give an equation about a terminal phase in the drug concentration time course. Okay, it can be given by an exponential term. Okay, and here concentration at time t is equal to a into e to the power of minus lambda I into t. Lambda I corresponds to your terminal rate constant and Ct concentration at time t and e is the coefficient. Okay, that's all about your non-compartment model. That's all about your today's session. Please do like, share and subscribe to my channel. Thank you very much.